Good evening, and welcome to our very much anticipated event, a lecture by Professor Roxanne Dunbar-Ortiz. This has been just a phenomenal amount of interest. I think on Facebook we've had 1,700 plus likes, or people have said they're going to be here. And this is great to see such a full room and to feel the buzz. So welcome tonight. My name is Samir Gandesha, and I'm the director of the Institute for the Humanities. I'm also an associate professor in the Department of Humanities here at SFU. First off, I'd like to acknowledge that this event is taking place on the unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, the Squamish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh nations. And I would also like to introduce and invite a very good friend of mine to come up and do a traditional welcome in just 1 second. Before I go on then to say a few words about the Institute and then also to introduce my colleague Deanna Rader, Professor Deanna Rader from English and First Nations Studies to introduce our speaker this evening. So join me in welcoming my friend, an associate of the Institute, very engaged activist, and member of the Musqueam Nation, to provide us with a traditional welcome this evening. Please welcome Audrey Siegel.
I'm really honored to also have a fellow Musqueam community member, Victor Guerin, to be with here tonight. It's not often I get to stand with someone from my community, so it makes my heart extra happy tonight. Get right to it. Mitzep Quadhuilum Atanash Musqueamash Tamoch Tanawel. Aik Gwinish Gwalowens Gwinsi Gwitsnala Schemtanak Gwinisquich Tinitsanat Humasqueam Tama Hwai Huikdan Itzlina August Kthinisitla. The English translation is welcome to the unceded lands of the Musqueam people. It gives me feelings of great joy to be here with you today. My name is Clem Tanat, also Audrey Siegel. I am from Musqueam, and I am the granddaughter of the late Stephen and Selena August. And I will let Victor introduce himself.
Silach I Ditamat na Sosila na Man I Quiselum I Mini Thomas na Sosila na Ten si I Quanis Quello in Quans Equitnala Tanakone si Siexia. Ladies and gentlemen, friends and relatives, as you've heard, my name is Victor Guerin, ancestral name Quichelum. I'm descended from Victor, my namesake Guerin, and Gertrude Guerin on my father's side, and Francis Point and Minnie Thomas on my mother's side. Francis Point is my ancestral namesake, Quichelum. This evening you're gathered on our ancestral territory, and it gives me a good feeling in my heart to see all of you here.
Thank you. I always love hearing Victor speak. Something that dawned on me today, I'm going to keep it short so we can do our best to stay on schedule. First, I would like to say hijka to Roxanne for taking the time to be here, for being the change since you were born, I'm guessing. because I was saying earlier, I had a monumental shift in my tectonic plates, as I call them today. I was listening to a man on the radio. I'm terrible. I keep switching until I find something I like. And this man was interesting for more than a second or two, so I stayed on the radio. And he was saying about hope. And for me personally, As a First Nations woman in Canada, hope has been a particularly dangerous word for me because, first of all, I'm not supposed to exist. And second of all, there is still ongoing battles and racism and genocide that we contend with as Canadians on a daily level, not just First Nations, but we are all aware of it now. And I'm sure everybody in this room feels it and cares and wants to be a part of the change so that we can all be, as they say, equal. And this man was talking about hope and how hope isn't just a feeling or a word, that hope actually becomes hope when it becomes an action. And I thought, oh, what, how, everything, I really had to pull over and process that because I wanted to grasp it. There was something in that, that I felt it, something inside of me like really shifted. And then I thought about it and I thought, for me, who has been terrified of the word hope my entire life, I have a new way to look at it. I asked my auntie 6 years ago, "What is our?" When I was learning our Hunkaminam language, "What is our word for love?" And she said, "We don't have one." I said, "How do you not have a word for love?" And she said, "Love is an action, not a word." And I thought, this is another one of these action words. This is fascinating. So for me, the act of us all being here together, joining intentionally with our energies, with our thoughts, having open minds and open hearts, which my granny taught me is how we do good work. This is hope in action. We are creating not just change, but we are creating the hope that keeps that change moving forward. So I say to each of you, don't just keep hoping, keep acting. And we have an amazing example of hope in action here tonight in Roxanne to share her amazing experiences and work, which mean a lot to me as a fellow woman and as a fellow warrior, I'll say, a truth speaker and a people like to say the underdog, but I'm not a big fan of that word. I just like to say we aren't the underdogs and we aren't just the oppressed. We are human beings who have been put in terrible situations. And when people shine their light on our truth so that people then can start to understand, it makes a big difference. So I say hi Sepka to each of you for being here, for caring, for doing your good work every day, big or small. It does make a difference. And there is a reason we are all doing this. And I love Eddie Vedder, and one of my favorite lines is, better days for all. This is what I'm working towards. So again, I say hi tsepka to each of you for being here, for caring, and for acting. And let's keep that hope alive by turning it into action. And let's start a hope movement, because so many people like me are scared of hope and scared to believe, but we have no choice but to believe, because if we don't, we're already defeated, and I will not accept that. So, thank you. And we will finish with, is it a Rose Green song? Rose Green from Hutlami, one of our relatives. This is one of our honor songs, and we would like to finish the welcome and properly get the evening off on a good note by sharing this song with you. Hey.
Well, thank you so much, Audrey and Victor. This is a wonderful welcoming. So I'd just like to say a couple of things about the Institute and then move on, of course, to the speaker that we're all waiting for. So the Institute has been around for just over three decades now, and its mission is to try and understand the critical political, social, economic, cultural issues of the day through the prism of the humanistic tradition, the Western humanistic tradition. People are however, rightfully confused at why an Institute for the Humanities organizes the kinds of critical events such as the one that we are hosting right now, insofar as the Institute is geared, really, to the Western tradition. And the Western tradition itself seems quite complicit in the very history, it seems, of settler colonialism that Professor Dunbar-Ortiz will be telling us about in just a few minutes. So this is a bit of a conundrum. Well, I think the key thing to bear in mind is that the Western tradition itself is deeply contradictory. There are elements within it which no doubt have historically supported and continue to support Eurocentrism, inequality, and the very liberal ideology of progress that has effectively erased the very existence of indigenous people from world history. For example, John Locke is a key figure in the Western humanistic tradition. I'm a political theorist, and often political theorists have to teach courses that run from Plato to NATO, and John Locke is a key figure in that particular lineage. His writings on epistemology and liberal social contract theory, and as Professor Dunbar-Ortiz shows, he's a key figure. So Locke is a key figure in articulating a justification for colonialism through his very understanding of property and his idea of terra nullius. At the same time, however, there exists something like a counter-tradition within the Western tradition more generally, and that has elaborated a powerful critique of colonization, of domination and exploitation, and it is precisely this counter-tradition that figures such as Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels, Rosa Luxemburg, Franz Fanon, Amilcar Cabral, Nelson Mandela, Patrice Lumumba, and others, and I think I could quite comfortably situate Professor Dunbar-Ortiz within that lineage as well, that seek to unbuild the master's house precisely by using his own tools. Right, so this is a kind of dialectical point. So in short, by aligning itself precisely with this counter tradition within the Western tradition itself, the Institute doesn't, to quote Bertolt Brecht, start from the good old things, but rather from the bad new ones. So our program for 2015-2016 reflects exactly this mission insofar as it recognizes that we have just passed through one of the most important general elections since Confederation. The program's title, which is State of Emergency, is taken from a TEDx talk given by one of our earlier speakers this year, who came in September, Professor Pam Palmiter, Chair of Indigenous Governance at Ryerson University. Coming just prior to Justice Murray Sinclair's release of the TRC report, Professor Palmiter drew attention to the fact that, particularly from an Indigenous perspective, Canada was and is in the midst of a state of emergency. The most obvious example of this was the previous government's stubborn refusal to mount an inquiry into Canada's national disgrace, the hundreds of missing and murdered Indigenous women over the past several decades. Perhaps this will change with the new government, but we don't know. We'll have to wait and see. And we'll have to actually put pressure on the government to do so. In 1940, Walter Benjamin wrote in his Reflections on History, quote, "The tradition of the oppressed teaches us that the state of emergency in which we live is not the exception but the rule. We must attain to a conception of history that is in keeping with this insight." There could scarcely be a more poignant assessment of the history of settler colonialism and its effects, particularly on Indigenous communities, not least because such an ongoing state of emergency that Benjamin refers to was brought about in the name of historical progress. And I think it's safe to say that Professor Dunbar-Ortiz does achieve this kind of understanding of history in her book. Much of our program has been accordingly geared to creating spaces in which serious issues that were not being addressed within the mainstream of the academy or the media could be addressed. And we feel as if we did contribute, if only modestly, to the best voter turnout in recent memory, which played an important factor in effecting an alliance between what Professor Palmiter calls the sword and the shield, an alliance between the Canadian electorate and First Nations communities, in bringing down what was surely one of the most authoritarian Canadian governments in recent memory. However, as we've seen brutally reinforced in recent days, the problems in this country run far deeper than this or that government, but have to do with the constitution of the state as a settler colonial state, a violent apparatus of historical and ongoing conquest oriented in particular to the land and its resources, and that has always been resisted by Indigenous peoples and their allies throughout the country and indeed throughout North America as a whole. The settler colonial nature of the state has only been driven home in a year that has that was supposed to be about reconciliation and moving the relationship between Indigenous and non-Indigenous people forward. We have seen this in this very province. A government that is alleged to have deliberately destroyed information subject to FOI requests relating to Highway 17 or the Highway of Tears that has seen the disappearance and or death of countless Indigenous girls and women. 3 years ago, investigations revealed the RCMP systemically abusing Indigenous people in northern BC, and now, most recently, just in the last couple of days, in a province that has sought to impose a charter of values, presumably to protect Muslim women from patriarchal domination, at least eight members of the Sûreté Québec suspended and placed under investigation by the Montreal police, which is questionable, obviously, for sexually assaulting Indigenous women. This is, of course, against a backdrop of a political landscape in which it is strictly verboten by all major political parties to make any kind of mention of the settler colonial policies and practices of the Israeli state, whose prime minister, by the way, has incredibly just blamed the Palestinians for the Holocaust, if you can believe it. This is itself oddly reminiscent of the head of the Quebec Police Union, who has just expressed worries that the police might be being scapegoated by Indigenous communities who are bringing forward allegations against the SQ. Here's a familiar case of the victim being construed as the aggressor. The key point is that the parallels between the two state forms are becoming harder and harder to deny. In a recent interview published in Salon magazine with UCLA historian and longtime editor of the New Left Review, Perry Anderson, about his new book on American foreign policy, we were reminded of the manner in which U.S. history can be understood through the lens of either exceptionalism or universalism. The first asserts the founding of the United States as a kind of covenant with God. Much of the discussion Professor Dunbar-Ortiz's book is taken up with this. The second asserts that this model could be taken as a universal model that should be emulated and indeed pushed globally. Incidentally, Perry Anderson seemingly has little to say about the colonial conquests of Indigenous land as part of the early history of the Republic, and this is surprising for someone who is otherwise rightly considered to be one of the most influential living radical historians. And one of the many considerable virtues of Professor Dunbar-Ortiz's book is that it shows how the two views are intimately related. That is, the exceptionalism of U.S. democracy comes to be exported in the Western Hemisphere first as part of manifest destiny in the 19th century and then globally after the Second World War. The internal colonization that happens through the 19th century in the push westward from the Atlantic to the Pacific serves as the model for the expansion of the U.S. state and capital globally in search of markets and resources. This point is made in a deeply poignant and telling paragraph at the beginning of chapter 4 of her book. And so just permit me to read this particularly arresting paragraph. Within days of the assassination of Osama bin Laden on May 2, 2011, it was revealed that the Navy SEAL team executing the mission had used the code name Geronimo for its target. A May 4th report in the New York Daily News commented, quote, along with the unseen pictures of Osama bin Laden's corpse and questions about what Pakistan knew, intelligence officials' reasons for dubbing the Al-Qaeda boss Geronimo remain one of the biggest mysteries of the Black Ops mission, end quote. The choice of that code name was not a mystery to the military, which also uses the term Indian country to designate enemy territory and identifies its killing machines and operations with such names as UH-1B/C Iroquois, OH/-58D Kiowa, OV-1 Mohawk, OH-6 Cayuse, AH-64 Apache, S-58/H-34 Choctaw, UH-60 Blackhawk, Thunderbird, and Rolling Thunder. The last of these is a military name given to the relentless carpet bombing of Vietnam peasants in the mid-1960s. There are many other current and recent examples of the persistence of colonialist and imperialist sensibilities at the core of a military grounded in wars against the indigenous nations and communities of North America. So before introducing our moderator for this evening, I'd like to first thank our partners for this event, who include SFU's Office of Community Engagement, Amjo Hall, thank you very much, and Andrea Kramer, the J.S. Woodsworth Chair in the Humanities, Eleanor Stebner, SFU's First Nations Studies, UBC's First Nations and Indigenous Studies Program, UBC's Institute for Critical Indigenous Studies, and last but not least, SFU's Department of History. I'd also like to thank, for manning the tables back there, Kavita Reddy, Megan Grant, and Peter Markin, and a big thank you especially to Hu Yan Pham, who basically is the engine house of the Institute. She runs the show, and she's doing an amazing job. Thank you, Hu Yan. I'd also like to mention that Roxanne's book, An Indigenous Peoples' History of the United States, is available at the back. Thank you to Banyan Books for bringing copies. They're available for $19 per item, and I believe Roxanne will be available for signing at the end. And one last thing, thank you to the Beehive Collective that's put the artwork together upstairs, which is just extraordinary. So thank you to them. So without any further ado, it gives me great pleasure now to introduce my colleague, Professor Deanna Rader, who is an associate professor in the Departments of First Nations Studies and English at SFU. Welcome, Deanna.
Nia Deanna Rader, Nia Apito Kustan, Isqueo, Kinanaskitin, to the people whose lands we are on, the traditional and unceded territories. What an honor it is to be here to introduce Roxanne Dunbar-Ortiz, who grew up in rural Oklahoma, the daughter of a tenant farmer and part Indian mother. She has been active in the international indigenous movement for more than four decades, knowing some of the people in this audience four decades ago, and is known for her lifelong commitment to national and international social justice issues. After receiving her PhD in history at the University of California in Los Angeles, she taught in the newly established Native American Studies program at California State University Hayward, and helped found the departments of Ethnic Studies and Women's Studies. Her 1977 book, The Great Sioux Nation, was the fundamental document at the first International Conference on Indigenous Peoples of the Americas, held at the United Nations headquarters in Geneva. Dunbar-Ortiz is the author or editor of seven other books, including Roots of Resistance, A History of Land Tenure in New Mexico. She lives in San Francisco. Please join me in a warm welcome to Roxanne Dunbar-Ortiz.
Wow, there are a lot of people here. Thank you all for coming out. And I'm so grateful to the Institute for Humanities for inviting me, and Huyen for working everything out, and of course Samir and all the other co-sponsors. I would like to recognize an important person who in my life, and I think for Native people of Canada, Ray Bob, who we met in the mid-70s, and Lee Miracle and others who were, we had a San Francisco, Vancouver relationship in a study group. So Ray is very important. Also one of the people I dedicate this book to, I dedicate it to Vine Deloria Jr. And Jack Forbes, both great Native historian, Jack Forbes, both have passed away. And also the late Howard Adams was Métis from Saskatchewan. And I have to attribute to Howard the germ of this idea for this book, An Indigenous Peoples History of the United States, because his book was Prison of Grass, A Native History of Canada. So I think that was so it's something that's kind of been lost through the generations, but I recommend all of you read that wonderful book and then somebody do a new Indigenous Peoples History of Canada, because I think that is much needed. And I don't pretend myself to be any kind of expert on Canada, so I'll mainly be referring to the United States, but also to so many things applied to North America in general, and I'm sure you will make the connections. But first I want to give my thanks and gratitude to the Coast Salish, the Musqueam, the Tsleil-Waututh, and Suquamish peoples in this unceded ancestral and traditional territories. Whenever I come here, I feel the strength, just as all the way down to down the coast and up, there's just something very specially powerful and preserved and dynamic, bringing the tradition together with modern resistance that benefits humanity, not just all Indigenous peoples. So what I've taken this from the book, but at the end I'll read a small passage, but it's also something I've just worked up for you, especially here. I tested it on a group of lawyers last week, the National Lawyers Guild, to see how it would go over non-Indigenous, mostly white lawyers, and they're radicals, you know, so I don't know exactly. The questions weren't that great, so I know I'm sure it will be better tonight. and we will have Q&A, so do be thinking of your questions and comments. I don't at all mind comments and instead of a question, as some people do. What's a question? What's a question? I don't do that. I'm trying to put my stopwatch on here, so I don't. Well, so I titled this Settler Colonialism and Genocidal Policies in North America, but as I say, I mainly concentrate on the United States. The difference between Canada and the United States, New Zealand, Australia, being kind of with Canada, is I think Canada is of course on the border, same border as the United States, and the same colonizers, only, you know, and we had Spanish and U.S. claimed territories, and you have French and British, so Spanish and British there. So there are a lot of mirror images. But one thing Canada is not is the largest military in human history. I know they're trying, you know, Harper really tried to catch up, but so you have that going for you. It makes it sometimes difficult. In the United States, it seems so overpowering. So we really look to Canada, you know, those of you in Canada, for going a lot farther and deeper. I think I've seen this ever since the 70s when we went to the International Forum in 1977, the Dene Nation people who were there. It was just that we got 2007, a Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People. It really goes back to the strength of the people at that time, the Haudenosaunee, who are kind of mostly in Canada, and the Dene. So United States government policies and actions related to Indigenous peoples, though often termed racist or discriminatory, are rarely depicted as what they are, a classic cases of imperialism and a particular form of colonialism, settler colonialism. Australian anthropologist Patrick Wolfe, he's written several books. He has another one coming out in a journal. He helped start on settler colonialism, which has really benefited the discussions that we didn't exactly have. We called it colonialism in the 70s, but we're looking at national liberation movements in Africa and all. And I think we have a clear understanding of this type of colonialism now, settler colonialism. And Wolf says, the question of genocide is never far from discussions of settler colonialism. Land is life, or at least land is necessary for life. The history of the United States, and I dare say Canada, is a history of settler colonialism. The objective of U.S. authorities was to terminate their existence as peoples, not as random individuals. And this is the very definition of modern genocide. Settler colonialism requires violence or the threat of violence to attain its goals, which then form the foundations of the United Nation, United States system, kind of the United Nations too. In employing the force necessary to accomplish its expansionist goals, a colonizing regime institutionalizes violence. The notion that settler-indigenous conflict is an inevitable product of cultural differences and misunderstandings, or that violence was committed equally by the colonized and the colonizer, blurs the nature of the historical processes. Euro-American colonialism, an aspect of capitalist economic globalization, had from its beginnings a genocidal intent, as inscribed in the papal bulls of the 15th century that produced the legalistic foundation for the first law of nations in the form of the doctrine of discovery. It also, doctrine of discovery also mandated African slavery in a papal bull of 1455. That was the first one to be able to conquer, occupy, and take into slavery every person that could be caught in West Africa and shipped to the slave auctions in Lisbon. So what constitutes genocide? Historian Gary Clayton Anderson, who is teaches the Native Studies courses at University of Oklahoma, that colonial institution in the state I come from, he's written a recent book last year called Ethnic Cleansing and the Indian. The whole book, about a 500-page book, is a litany of horrible violations against Native people by the United States government. But his conclusion is that genocide will never become a widely accepted characterization for what happened in North America, because large numbers of Indians survived, and because policies of mass murder on a scale similar to events in Central Europe, Cambodia, or Rwanda were never implemented. He also argues that genocide did not occur in the United States primarily because moral restraints prevented it. Another scholar, a professor of criminology and criminal justice, Alex Alvarez, in his recent book, Native American and the Question of Genocide, these both came out exactly when my book came out, he insists that what he calls cultural genocide did occur, but that it did not is not included in, he claims it's not included in the UN Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide. So there are fatal errors in those assessments and their convoluted attempts to remove genocide as a concept that fits what the United States government carried out, both of them admitting to many crimes and abuses. Following the Shoah, or Holocaust, Polish lawyer Rafael Lemkin, who had fled the Nazis, ending up in the United States, coined the word genocide. Lemkin argued that the existing laws prohibiting war crimes were not sufficient to deal with targeting of specific groups, which could also occur without war necessarily being like the pogroms of the past that led up to the genocide. He combined the Greek word for race or tribe and the Latin word for killing into the word genocide. He saw genocide as a strategy, not an event. He tirelessly lobbied the new United Nations to produce a convention, and the result was the United Nations Convention presented in 1948 and adopted in 1951, the UN Convention on the Prevention, and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide. The convention is not retroactive, but is applicable, I think it's applicable in Canada from its signing. But it's only applicable in the United States since 1988, when the US Senate finally ratified it 40 years after its writing. But the Genocide Convention is also an essential tool for historical analysis of the effects of colonialism in any era, and particularly in US history. In the convention, any one of five acts is considered genocide if, quote, committed with intent to destroy in whole or in part a national, ethnic, racial, or religious group. And this, these include five specifics, but any one of them can be judged to be genocide. So one is obviously killing members of the group, but actually in theory, the Genocide Convention could apply even if no one is killed physically. Because the next one is causing serious bodily or mental harm to members of the group. I don't know why Mr. Alvarez didn't see the cultural in that, what is already in this treaty. Another is deliberately inflicting on the group conditions of life calculated to bring about its physical destruction in whole or in part. Another is imposing measures intended to prevent births within the group. And finally, forcibly transferring children of the group to another group. So that's the exact language of it's a very simple treaty. Anyone can go read it online. So the following acts are punishment. One act is punishable, yes, genocide. But there's also conspiracy to commit genocide, direct and public incitement to commit genocide, attempt to commit genocide, and complicity in genocide. So the term genocide is often incorrectly used, such as in Dr. Anderson and Dr. Alvarez's statements, their assessments, to describe extreme examples of mass murder, the death of vast numbers of people, just the worst thing that ever happened. As for instance, in Cambodia. What took place in Cambodia was horrific, but it does not fall under the terms of the Genocide Convention. This is the misunderstanding, as the convention specifically refers to a national, ethnic, racial, or religious group, with individuals within that group targeted by a government or its agents because they are members of that group, or by attacking the underpinnings of the group's existence as a group, being met with the intent to destroy the group in whole or in part. The Cambodian government under the Khmer Rouge committed war crimes, horrific war crimes, and there are all kinds of treaties on war crimes, and also crimes against humanity, but not genocide. It's a very specific thing. It's not simply an act, worse than anything else, rather this specific kind of act. The term ethnic cleansing is a descriptive term created by humanitarian interventionists and NATO to describe what was said to be happening in the 1990s wars among the republics of Yugoslavia. It is a descriptive term, not a term of international humanitarian law, and it is the term favored by Dr. Anderson. He says that's what it should be called, what happened in the United States. Although clearly the Holocaust was the most extreme of all genocides, compressed in a period of time, the bar that was set by the Nazis is not the bar required to be considered genocide. The title of the Genocide Convention is a crime, is the Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide. That means before it even happens, the what is leading up to that is this extraction, is this making existence unlikely another generation for some peoples. And you can think of a lot of incidents. So it's preemptive. It needs to be preemptive, not just a punishment when it takes place. That's, you know, what happened to the Jews and the Gypsies. All these persecutions have been taking place ever since the rise of Christendom. But it led to something so that that should not happen again. And most importantly, genocide certainly does not have to be complete to be considered genocide. That's ridiculous. Saying there were too many Indians left, 10% of the original population, is really ludicrous. I guess that means you have to follow the logic and say, well, there was really no genocide against Jews because too many Jews survived. No one would say that. U.S. history and its role in the world today, as well as generational indigenous trauma, cannot be understood without dealing with genocide that the United States committed against indigenous peoples. From the colonial period through the founding of the United States and continuing in the 20th century, this has entailed torture, sexual abuse, massacres, systematic military occupations, removals of indigenous peoples from their ancestral territories, forced removal of Native American children to military-like boarding schools, allotment, and a policy of termination, 1953. Within the logic of settler colonialism, genocide was the inherent overall policy of the United States from its founding. But there are also specific documented policies of genocide on the part of U.S. administrations that can be identified in at least four distinct periods. And I would encourage you, you know, researchers, students, and historians to and legal specialists, to look into Canada, you know, some of these things, because I think they're probably more glaring in the United States, but that doesn't mean they're not just as justified being under the Genocide Convention. So these four distinct periods that I've identified, it might not be everyone's list, but for sure, we'd have to look at the Jacksonian era of forced removal of all of the Native people east of the Mississippi, all of whom were farmers, and one of the seven sites of the rise of agricultural civilizations to make way for plantation agriculture worked by slaves that built the U.S. economy. Another is the California Gold Rush in Northern California, which is, there are books written, several books written, that call this extermination, a policy of extermination. Sort of like Tasmania, you know, the hunting for Native people to kill them and wiping them out. Another is during the Civil War, which rarely gets mentioned, the Sand Creek Massacre, the removal of the Navajo Nation to a desert place where half the population died of starvation, malnutrition, and exposure. And that was during the Civil War. And then afterwards, the post-Civil War era, led by those generals, those Union generals, who were very advanced in counterinsurgency from way back, the Indians, but also not to defend the Confederacy, but is mostly attacking people in their homes and fields in the South that the war took place. It didn't take place in the North. So another are the so-called, well, the Indian Wars and through the Great Plains. So this goes up to the massacre at Wounded Knee in 1890. By the way, that massacre where more than 300 refugees, starving Lakota refugees in the middle of South Dakota winter, were trying to turn themselves in to the Pine Ridge Agency, to the feds, so the people could eat, because it was mostly women and children, elderly men left. So they were surrounded by Custer's old cavalry, the 7th Cavalry, and shot like a turkey shoot, laying dead in the snow. For that, 20 Congressional Medals of Honor were given out to the soldiers who did this. They've never been retracted. And in the military annals, it's not called a massacre, it's called a battle. And in the column, win or loss, it's a win. So you see, this is now. Then finally, I think, and most importantly for present purposes, for what we might do with this, is the 1950s termination period in the United States. Then there's this overlapping period of compulsory boarding schools from the 1870s to the 1960s. They actually started, they were religious ones, in the 1820s, but they were not compulsory until the first federal boarding school was set up, the Carlisle Boarding School, founded by U.S. Army officer Richard Henry Pratt in 1879, became a model for others established by the Bureau of Indian Affairs. Pratt said in a speech in 1892, quote, "A great general has said that the only good Indian is a dead one. In a sense, I agree with the sentiment, but only in this, that all the Indian there is in the race should be dead. Kill the Indian in him and save the man." Now, that's the exact definition of genocide. Cases of genocide carried out as policy may be found in historical documents as well as oral histories in indigenous communities. An example from 1873 is typical in the U.S. military documents, with General William T. Sherman, the invader of famous Burning Atlanta, the great Union general. And he's now in the West, the head of the whole Army of the West, which is like six of the seven divisions of the U.S. Army after the Civil War moved out into the West, the Northern Plains and the Southwest. He said in 1873, "We must act with vindictive earnestness against the Sioux, even to their extermination, men, women, and children. During an assault, the soldiers cannot pause to distinguish between male and female, or even discriminate as to age." And that's very typical. You don't have to, you go through these telegrams and documents, and that is the rhetoric, the orders being given to the soldiers. So the Indian Wars, so-called, in U.S. history annals, carried out by settler militias of the colonies, continued during the decade of war of the War of Secession from Britain and after, technically ending around 1880, although the Wounded Knee massacre occurred a decade later. Whether 1880 or 1890, most of the collective land base that Native nations secured through hard-fought-for treaties made with the United States was actually lost after Native resistance was mostly subdued by 1880. After the end of the wars came allotment in the 1880s, another policy of genocide of Native nations, as peoples, the dissolution of the group. And in Oklahoma, where I came from, it's all allotted, everything was allotted. There was oil there, so it became oil allotments. Most of the other reservations. By the time of the New Deal, John Collier era, John Collier was an advocate of Indigenous people's rights. He had worked with people in the Pacific. There were a lot of lefties in Roosevelt's cabinet. I think under that saying of keep your friends close but keep your enemies closer, I think it was a little manipulation of many of them that we should think about. So what he designed and implemented, and he certainly did consult with some Native peoples, particularly Taos Pueblo, of what could be done to reverse the situation of disappearance, because literally Native people were going to disappear if things continued with such impoverishment, isolation, and lack of any kind of secure land base. So the end result was the Indian Reorganization Act, which immediately ended allotment, but it didn't restore the lands that were allotted. But at that time, non-Indians outnumbered Indians on reservations 3-1. And land restitution or compensation was not mandated. It did mandate the government should take affirmative action to purchase any land, private land that in that former territory to restore it to the nation. But that's still the law, but the federal government does not initiate it, so it's very expensive, and then it has to get put into trust once it's bought, you know, buying it and then putting it into trust. So it's a very complicated and expensive procedure. And for the majority of Native nations, the Indian Reorganization Act proved harmful and divisive because many, like Taos, which actually didn't in the end ratify it, and the Navajo Nation didn't either, the Hopi did because they were controlled by a a Mormon faction, and they're very traditional. Very few people spoke English. So where there were strong traditional governments, these new governments of people who could speak English, often not even their native language, taking over the governing. So this is really what the Wounded Knee 1973 was about, was the Indian Reorganization Act and the oppressive tribal government there. So I like to quote the late Matthew King, an elder traditional historian of the Oglala Sioux, who observed, the Bureau of Indian Affairs drew up the constitution and bylaws of this organization, the Indian Reorganization Act. This was the introduction of home rule. This is a man who never went to a school, but he knew what home rule was. The traditional people still hang on to our treaty, the 1868 treaty, for we are a sovereign nation. We have our own government. Home rule, or neocolonialism, proved a short-lived policy, however, for in the early 1950s, the United States developed its termination policy, and that's what they called it, termination, the Termination Act. This legislation that ordered gradual eradication of every land base and even those tribal governments that they had set up under the Indian Reorganization Act. So Pawnee attorney Walter Echohawk writes, in 1881, Indian land holdings in the United States had plummeted to 156 million acres. By 1934, only about 50 million acres remained, an area the size of Idaho and Washington, as a result of the General Allotment Act of 1887. During World War II, the government took 500,000 more acres for military use. Over 100 Native nations relinquished their lands under various acts of Congress during the termination era of the 1950s. Historians and others who deny genocide emphasize population attrition by disease, weakening indigenous peoples' ability to resist. This is what Gary Anderson took another track and said, oh, look at them all out there persecuting him because they hate him on that campus. But there's so many Indians here, you know, that... But for most historians, they argue that the native peoples were just overpowered by the strength of the United States, and isn't that a shame, but it wasn't genocide. That it wasn't genocide by plan. They just dropped dead every time a European got near them, you know, they're gone. It wasn't because they were herded into refugee camps without food or water and any kind of medical care or their traditional medicine. But if disease, I've always contemplated this, because there were a lot of diseases, but how do they happen? How's it happening in Syrian refugee camps in Turkey right now? Or the Syrian refugee camps in the Afghan refugee camps in Pakistan, disease spreads like crazy in these, you know, unclean, unhygienic, poor food in those situations. But I say if disease could have done the job, it is not clear why the United States took so much trouble and found it necessary to carry out unrelenting wars against the indigenous communities and nations in order to gain every inch of land they took from them. Along with the prior period of British colonization, nearly 300 years of eliminationist warfare. In the case of the Jewish Holocaust, no one denies that more Jews died of starvation, overwork, and disease under Nazi incarceration than died in gas ovens per se or murdered by other means. Yet the acts of creating and maintaining the conditions that led to those deaths clearly constitute genocide. And of course, genocide was not complete. Not all of the acts iterated in the Genocide Convention are required to exist to constitute genocide. Any one of them suffices. I'm sure you can find cases in Canada, but here are some cases, the United States genocidal policies and actions under each of the categories, not just the four I talked about. The first, killing members of the group. The Genocide Convention does not specify that large numbers of people must be killed in order to constitute genocide, rather that members of the group are killed because they are members of the group. Assessing a situation in terms of preventing genocide, this kind of killing or conditions that, let's say, in the black community, I think this is very applicable to police brutality as well as mass incarceration. Second, causing serious bodily or mental harm to members of the group, such as starvation, the control of food supply and withholding food as punishment or a reward for compliance, for instance, in signing confiscatory treaties, the use of alcohol, barrels of alcohol being brought to treaty negotiations. As military historian John Grenier points out in his First Way of War, and I do use that, that's an amazing book. He wrote, for the first 200 years of our military heritage, he's a commander in the U.S. Air Force and has a doctorate in history and teaches at the Air Force College. And I was shocked that, of course, no one in the world has read this book but me. Hopefully other people. I mean, it's out there. You can get it on Amazon. So he wrote, for the first 200 years of military heritage then, Americans depended on arts of war that contemporary professional soldiers supposedly abhorred, raising and destroying enemy villages and fields, killing enemy women and children, raiding settlements for captives, intimidating and brutalizing enemy noncombatants, and assassinating enemy leaders. These are Indians, the enemy. In the frontier wars between 1607 and 1814, Americans forged two elements, unlimited war and irregular war, into their first way of war. Grenier goes on to argue that not only did this way of war continue throughout the 19th century in wars against indigenous nations, but continued in the 20th century and currently in counterinsurgent wars against peoples in Latin America, the Caribbean and Pacific, Southeast Asia, Middle and Western Asia, and Africa. Third, deliberately inflicting on the group conditions of life calculated to bring about its physical destruction in whole or in part. Forced removal of all the indigenous nations east of the Mississippi to Indian territory during the Jackson administration was clearly a calculated policy intent on destroying these people's ties to their original homelands and knowing exactly what that meant, as well as declaring Native people who did not remove to no longer be Muscogee, Sauk, Kickapoo, Choctaw, but destroying the existence of up to half of each nation removed. Mandatory boarding schools comes under the deliberately inflicting on the group conditions of life calculated to bring about their physical destruction in whole or in part. Allotment and termination, all official government policies fall under this category of the crime of genocide. The forced removal and forced incarceration of the Navajo people resulted in the death of half their population and applies. Fourth, imposing measures intended to prevent births within the group. Well, I don't know if you know this, it was pretty well known in the 1970s, but it was famously during the Termination Act, there was another little termination taking place. The U.S. government-administered Indian Health Service made the top medical priority the sterilization of indigenous women. In 1974, an independent study by one of the few Native American physicians at the time, Dr. Connie Pinkerton Urey, a Choctaw Cherokee from Oklahoma, found that one in four Native women had been sterilized without her consent. Pinkerton Urey's research indicated that the Indian Health Service had, quote, singled out full-blooded Indian women for sterilization procedures. At first denied by the Indian Health Service, 2 years later, a study by the U.S. General Accounting Office found that four of the 12 Indian Health Service regions sterilized 3,406 Native women without their permission between 1973 and 1976 in a three-year period of time. They also found that 36 women under the age of 21 had been forcibly sterilized during this period, despite a court-ordered moratorium on sterilization of women younger than 21. And I remember watching finally the press conference, because this was beginning to be, this was the height of red power when this was happening, and people were really protesting this, that it was continuing. And so the head of the health service, Indian Health Service, came on national TV, and he said, "We're really sorry, but this is the cure for poverty. Poverty means too many people." That's what they were using in India at the time. The sterilization, also in Brazil, to eradicate poverty. So they did stop then, but he admitted that it was the number one priority of the Indian Health Service. Their number one health issue was to make sure Native women weren't having so many children. So fifth, forcibly transferring children of the group to another group. Various government entities, mostly municipalities, counties, and states, routinely removed Native children from their families and put them up for adoption. In the Native resistance movements of the 1960s and 1970s, the demand to stop this practice was codified in the Indian Child Welfare Act of 1978. And that act said that no Native child, wherever, in anywhere in the country, in any urban area, anywhere, but identified Native child could be adopted outside their own family or clan or simply their nation. You know, say the mother is dead and there are no relatives, then the nation itself. And then by that time, you know, there's certainly not going to be any adoptions out. But the legislation provided no financial resources for Native governments to establish infrastructure to retrieve children from the adoption industry, in which ghoulishly, Indian babies were in high demand. After U.S. wars, it really is ghoulish, but they had these Operation Baby lists, you know, the Korean babies and the Japanese, I mean, the Vietnamese babies. It's people want to, it's that possession thing, but it's especially strong about Indian children. So despite these barriers to enforcement, the worst abuses, the word had gotten around, and they had been curbed in the following three decades. But on June 25th, 2013, the U.S. Supreme Court, in a 5-4 ruling drafted by Justice Samuel Alito, used provisions of the Indian Child Welfare Act to say that a child widely known as Baby Veronica did not have to live with her biological Cherokee father. The High Court's decision paved the way for Matt and Melanie Copa Bianca the adopted parents to ask the South Carolina courts, where they're from, to have the child returned to them. The court gutted the purpose and intent of the Indian Child Welfare Act, missing the concept behind it, the protection of the cultural resource and treasure that are Native children, not about protecting so-called traditional or nuclear families, the Cherokee father. It's about recognizing the prevalence of extended families and culture. So why does the Genocide Convention matter? Since it's controversial and since there's so many misinterpretations, why use it? Why not just say ethnic cleansing? Well, it's not just history that predates the 1948 Genocide Convention or the U.S. signing of it in 1988, but the history is important and needs to be widely aired, including public school texts and public service announcements, because it's linked to what is the situation right now. The doctrine of discovery is still the law of the land in the United States. From the 15th century to the 20th century, most of the non-European world was colonized under the doctrine of discovery, one of the first principles of international law that Christian European monarchies promulgated to legitimize investigating, mapping, and claiming lands belonging to peoples outside of Europe. It originated in a papal bull issued in 1455 that permitted the Portuguese monarchy to seize West Africa for slave raiding, initiating the Atlantic slave trade. Following Columbus's infamous exploratory voyage in 1492, sponsored by the king and queen of the infant Spanish state, another papal bull had extended similar permission to Spain in the Western Hemisphere. Disputes between the Portuguese and Spanish monarchies led to the papal-initiated Treaty of Tordesillas of 1494, which, besides dividing the globe equally between the two Iberian empires, clarified that only non-Christian lands fell under the doctrine of discovery. This doctrine, on which all European states and Euro-American, upon which they relied, originated in this arbitrary and unilateral establishment of the Iberian monarchy's exclusive rights under Christian canon law to take anything they wanted. But it wasn't just monarchies. It can't be said just to be a medieval relic just because it happened in the 15th century. The French Republic used, after its revolution, used this legalistic instrument for its 19th and 20th century settler-colonialist projects, which continue in the Caribbean and the Pacific, as did the newly independent United States when it continued the colonization of North America begun by the British and continues to hold island colonies in the Caribbean and Pacific as well. In 1792, not long after the founding of the United States, Thomas Jefferson, who was then Secretary of State before he was president, claimed that the doctrine of discovery developed by European states was international law applicable to the new U.S. government as well. And then in 1823, the U.S. Supreme Court issued a decision in a Cherokee case, Johnson versus McIntosh, and writing for the majority, Chief Justice Marshall held that the doctrine of discovery had been an established principle of European law and English law in effect in Britain's North American colonies, and was also the law of the United States. So it's very interesting, you know, the conceit is always that the United States broke away as this little scrabble, poor little colonies, and made a complete break from Britain, but they kept their international law for colonizing. So this court, John Marshall's Supreme Court, defined the exclusive property rights that a European country acquired by dint of discovery. Discovery gave title to the government, this is his language, by whose subjects or by whose authority it was made, against all other European governments. Forget about the people inside it. which title might be consummated by possession. So this is like possession means warfare to take it. So he did say the court, and in two other cases, came up with this domestic dependent nations. But Marshall also said in no instance is our indigenous rights disregarded, but necessarily to a considerable extent, his language, impaired. The court further held that indigenous rights to complete sovereignty as independent states were necessarily diminished. Indigenous peoples could continue to live on the land at the grace of the government, but the title resided in the discovering power, the United States. The decision concluded that Native nations were domestic dependent nations. So that is still the law. As recently as 2009, I think it was, there was another Supreme Court decision in a Cayuga Oneida case, land case, in which the doctrine of discovery and those decisions from 1820s were used to deny the Oneidas their claim. So the doctrine of discovery is so taken for granted in the settler society. It's also in effect here. You don't have the legislation that goes along with it, but it's assumed in the treatment of the property rights. It's rarely ever mentioned in historical or legal texts published in the Americas. United Nations Permanent Forum on Indigenous Peoples, which meets annually for 2 weeks in New York at the UN, devoted its entire 2012 session to the doctrine. And all of those documents are available, archived on the UN United Nations website. But few U.S. citizens are aware of the precarity of the situation of indigenous peoples in the United States. Now, I want to read just a short piece. I have a couple more minutes, and that's how long it will take. I don't know if any of you have ever heard of this place, but I think it's a good way to end, and I think it probably applies in Canada too. It's a section of the conclusion called Ghosts and Demons to Hide From. A living symbol of the genocidal history of the United States, as well as a kind of general subconscious knowledge of it, is the Winchester Mystery House. It's also near Halloween, so that's it. It becomes a big place for Halloween. It's a tourist site in the Santa Clara Silicon Valley of Northern California, 50 miles south of San Francisco. It is billed as a ghost house on billboards that start appearing, as far as I know, maybe in Vancouver, but certainly in Seattle, all the way down the coast. And the south from San Diego all the way up, big signs, you know, visit, and has ghoulish kind of figures and ghosts and on the billboards. So Sarah L. Winchester, the wealthy widow of William Wirt Winchester, built the Victorian mansion to avoid and elude ghosts. That's precisely why she built the house. Although there is no record of the ghosts ever being found in her home, it could be said that perhaps Mrs. Winchester's project from 1884 to her death in 1922 was a success. She likely was very well aware of the widely publicized ghost dance in 1890, which led to the killing of Sitting Bull and the Wounded Knee Massacre. The dancers believed that the dance would bring back their dead warriors and civilians, all who were shot, died unnaturally by bullets. It makes sense that Mrs. Winchester felt the need to guard herself from the ghosts of those killed by the Winchester repeating rifle, which her late husband's father had invented and produced in 1866, with later models being even more lethal. Mrs. Winchester inherited the fortune accumulated by her husband's family, and she was the only surviving, you know, in-law member of the family. So it all went to her, huge fortune. There was only one major purchaser of the Winchester rifle, and it was designed for that purchaser, the U.S. Department of War, which it was rightly called and still should be called. They changed it in World War II to Department of Defense. The chief reason for the War Department's purchases of the rifle in great quantities was one purpose: to kill Indians. The rifle was a technological innovation designed especially for the U.S. Army's campaigns against the Plains Indians following the Civil War. It's sort of like the M16 rifle in Vietnam, and even now the M16 was the Winchester at that time, up until World War II and the war and wars. The Winchester house, that they call a mystery house, amazes all who tour it. There are 5 floors, more or less, since they are staggered. It's hard to tell. Each room in itself appears normal, more or less. It's decorated in the late 19th century Victorian mode, you know, with velvet couches and very uncomfortable little couches and chairs and wallpaper and, you know, a lot of things. But there's more than meets the eye in getting from parlors to bedrooms to kitchen to closets and from floor to floor. Numerous stairways dead end, and secret trap doors hide the actual stairways. Closet doors open to walls, and pieces of furniture are really doors to closets. Huge bookcases serve as entrances to adjoining rooms. Part of the house was unfinished. When the widow died, she kept building on it, as she had construction workers building every day from when she started it till the day she died, from dawn to dusk, 7 days a week, adding rooms and traps until her death. Visitors tracking through the widow's home are astounded and perhaps saddened, although there's a lot of joking too, crazy old lady, of course, by the evidence all around them of the fears and anguish of an obviously mentally disturbed person. Yet there is another possibility, a sense of the scaffolding that supports U.S. society, a kind of hologram in the minds of each and every person on the continent. Mrs. Winchester might have been more aware of the truth than most people, and therefore fearful of its consequences, as everyone should be. Regardless, in continuing to find or invent enemies across the globe, expand what is already the largest military force in the world, and add to an elaborate global network of 1,000 military bases, all in the name of national or global security, does not the United States today resemble Mrs. Winchester constantly trying to foil her ghosts? The guilt harbored by most is buried and expressed in other ways, including gun violence on a larger scale, regeneration through violence, as Richard Slotkin puts it. Thank you.
We do have a microphone here, and I'm happy to keep my eye open for hands in the audience.
Oh, we're here.
Yes.
Is there an Indian act in the United States?
ascribe to Indians as a people in the country, as opposed to like global currencies, as being my allegiance to. And I'm just very interested because this is happening in our country today. They deny that they're doing this. But you mentioned some sort of act that happened to the termination policy in the 50s. And here, in 1973, we have the comprehensive biodiversity policy. And in this policy, which governs all of the treaties, it's not negotiable to separate the people and the community from the country.
Thank you, Ray. Yeah, I think there are similarities, and I don't think termination in the United States came at, I'm sure there was Cold War hysteria in Canada as well, but you certainly had not anything like the United States, where two people were executed, burned alive, you know, for being communists. And the blacklisting, this was enunciated in Congress when they were discussing termination, that these were communistic societies within the United States that had to be done away with. And the allotment back in the 1880s, before communism, the word, you know, was really prevalent in the United States, there was just a socialist, a kind of democratic socialist, sort of like Bernie Sanders, named Henry George, who wanted everyone to get along and for there to be no war and to share things. And Dawes, the senator who designed the Allotment Act, his specific reason for doing it was that Native people were socialistic like Henry George. It was that system, and they can never achieve civilization unless they learn the value of selfishness. It reminds you of that Wall Street movie, of greed is good, you know. I have a subsection called that. But I think that was very specific to the United States, and it's, you know, this disease of anti-communism, which didn't go away with the end of, you know, the Soviet Union. It still pervades everything. So that, I think, is different, but I think the intent of the Canadian government is always seems more subtle to those of us in the United States because it's such a blunt instrument in the United States. They're getting slicker about it. I think they're looking at Canada, seeing how are they doing things. The main thing in the United States, this whole neoliberal force that's very attractive to you know, the U.S. American psyche, is privatization of everything, doing away with all government, municipal, every kind of government, and privatizing everything. And they're privatizing the universities by making every faculty person an endowed, you know, at, by the way, University of Oklahoma, the chair of Native American Studies is the Coca-Cola chair of Native American Studies. I'm not kidding. This, and or else it wouldn't be there, you know. So anyway, I think the real fear now, and we're reading, you know, these right-wing think tanks just churn out so much stuff, and it's so deadly to read. But we've been trying to keep up with it, and some of it they keep kind of secret, so it's not always easy to get hold of it. But it is very clear that they're starting plans for proposing to what they call the tribes, tribal governments, to become corporations, like they were able to do in Alaska when the Alaskan Native people and Indians and Inuits were not that well organized to fight the Alaska Native Claims Act. So that basically making the citizens of a Native nation stockholders in a corporation. And then the land would be their private property. And in that way, they would just become good, you know, enterprises, and they would get investments from wealthy people and so forth. So this is the main, it's not the first time they've tried that. They tried red capitalism, it was called, in the 60s. And they were pushing it, and that kind of fell apart because they built all these factories on in Native nations, like the Navajo, the Fairchild, is a military contract. In Vietnam, they created the electronic battlefield, this Fairchild electronics. And they were paying the workers, they weren't paying the workers. The federal government was paying the workers the first 3 months of training. So they were paid, but they were paid by the feds. Didn't cost a single penny for. So what they started doing is just laying off those people and hiring more. So they literally were not paying salaries to these people. And so they organized themselves, the Navajo workers did, and they to form a union. And Fairchild just, they had spent millions and millions of dollars on this layout that's only specifically for electronics production. No one can use it really for anything else. They just folded up shop and went to Taiwan, where, you know, the salaries were a little less than minimum wage in the United States, which they would be paying. So that kind of burst the bubble of, you know, of red capitalism in 1975. But privatization, I think probably is more a fear there than in Canada. I think there are other issues that have to be dealt with in relation to the state, that there it's, you know, this insidious kind of privatization that's going on. I mean, it's just, it's really, everything is now, you know, privatized, and there are lots of fights about, you know, Airbnb and Uber and all these things, but it's kind of a losing proposition. Yes. Wow. So you have to be a chameleon.
Thank you for your presentation here. It was so interesting, and it's so similar to what we go through here as BC Indigenous people, the only unceded territory in Canada. And we fought for our land and our rights, our family and our children, our grandmothers. And it still feels so endless today. But I feel like I have to speak out, because what you've been saying about the United States, Indigenous people, is just exactly what's going on here in BC. Never mind the rest of Canada, but right here in BC is the only unceded territory. And I fought for my land and my rights and my people for 60 years now, and I'll be 63 in the next few days. And it does feel like it's never ending for us as Indigenous people. We don't have no support from people anywhere. We stand on our own 2 feet. We fight for what is rightfully ours. And it's hard to get lawyers. And it's hard to get places to speak up like this, what you get here. We're denied everything. We're denied too many things. Yet this is ours, as Indigenous people of this land. But I see it, more and more people come out to things like this. Why don't you go out there to the land and see what we live out there? See how the animals live. All living things out there need your help too. Not just you sitting here in the city. I used to sit here in the city too before I woke up and realized what's happening to my family, my land. My sisters and I had to go through, myself, I went through 5 abortions before I was 20. That's uncalled for in my land. No, right. My sisters go through the same thing. My mom, my grandma fought for us. They took all the men who
happened. You don't know. I hurt. You don't care to listen to us. What happened to us? What happened to the people that whose land you guys all sit on? Many of our people suffered. We buried many. I buried my whole family in the last 30 years. Just because I'm speaking out like this. Because I want to make it right for me, my children, and your children, your grandchildren. But I really fight for my own kids' rights. And no one speaks up for them. I have a voice deep inside of me and in my heart. I want this to be known. This is genocide, what's happened to us. What is happening to us. And it's gotta be ended sometime now. The change has to happen now. Not only for the way you lived, the way you treated my land here in Burns Lake, BC, our water, our air, and you don't care. Time you started caring because it's not gonna be there very long. It didn't last us long to lose it all to you. How much longer are you going to sit there on your butts and do nothing but listen? I'm scared. I'm scared what's going to happen in the future because I see what happened in the last 50 years with us as Indigenous people of this land. I buried too many men. Too many, and I see too many buried in his family too. We are the traditional people of this land. We are the real people of this land. You don't see us very often. You don't hear us very often. But it's time you did. It's history right here. We're history. And we're so lucky to be alive today, even though we got beaten up by so many policemen in our 60 years.
Yes.
So many.
Thank you.
Now it's time for a change, and if you want change, it's you gonna make the change now. Because we need change. They're all suffering, all living things, the fish, the bears, the coyotes, us as Indigenous people, we shouldn't have to suffer. Time we all stood together. Right. Thank you.
Thank you.
This talking stick here represents our tribes and our people. Each one of these animals on this talking stick represents a big family that goes with a piece of our land. And each family governs the piece of land that goes with these animals. And these are all our clans that represent our families on our land. This is our agreement between ourselves and our tribes that you people have to understand. We have no treaties here in this province. And because we have no treaties, we have inherent rights that this government has to pay attention to in regards to the genocidal practices that have been continuing to commit against our families and our tribal people. My wife is in this electric scooter because she got ran off the highway by the RCMP 13 years ago. And it continues yet today, the abuse of the RCMP against our tribal people who stand up for our rights. You take a look at the standoffs that went off in this province alone, and it's going to get worse unless we all get together and make some form of agreement between ourselves, because this is unceded land. We have never ever lost it in a war, and we never signed it away in a treaty or given any of the rights away to any of the resources on this land that's being extracted by all of the corporations and companies that are devastating not just your future, but the future of my grandchildren and myself. So I say that the acts of genocide are true and real, and are going on today. Coming here today to this meeting, we're followed by the RCMP from Chilliwack and the Fraser Valley to here. And recently, my wife was pulled off her electric scooter by an RCMP in the Fraser Valley. So the ongoing attacks on land defenders and on people who stand up for rights, it's like what happened in Wounded Knee, what was he talking about. In the 70s, when the people stood up against uranium mining over there, here too, it's the same thing. It's about the resource and resource extraction of the lands and an ongoing genocide of our people. Thanks for listening to me. And this is the marking of my land. My great-great-grandfather, his name was Mungo Martin. He carved a 120-foot totem pole and he gave it to the Queen of England so that she may remember that this is our land. And there's a copy of that pole down here by the planetarium in Vancouver to remind us that that totem pole marks the territories of the lands that we come from, and I carry our land markers around with us because it reminds me every day that I have a struggle, and my struggle is to educate you people. Thanks for listening. Thanks for coming in.
Yes, I'd like to say thank you also. And I'd like to say that what she's saying, it's time for everybody to warrior up here and get to the front lines and help our Indian people. Okay. And one of the things, you know, to ask a question to you, you know, the Constitution, the Spanish court, Constitutional Court, has had some genocide court cases tried there, and it's Rigoberto Menchu who has brought the president and generals and has charged them with genocide for what they've done to the Mayan people there. Right. Could you elaborate a bit about that? And one other thing, besides all the, you know, doom and gloom that we survived through, you know, there's the Pueblo Court of Indian Land Claims. Are you familiar with that?
Yes, 1922.
Yeah, and it's Article 8 of the Treaty of Guadalupe. And what they had to do is they had to move 30,000 non-natives off their land. And they had to restore the Pueblo's land and water rights. Now, those are precedents set like subliminous deuce. So those are remedies here that we can, you know, enact and breathe life into. So could you elaborate a bit about maybe those three things to, you know, besides all the doom and gloom, there are, you know, there is a good papal bull, subliminous deuce. And
there's
is the court claims, and there is people going to jail and for genocide. So let us know what you know.
Yes, I think, you know, if I had longer to speak, I would. Definitely, when I talk about genocide, I want to emphasize that there's something else, a kind of trapdoor when you talk about genocide. I think it's really important that we establish it and not let the knee-jerk reaction be, yes, that was terrible, but let's move on. And that is what Michael Cox, a Native scholar at Stanford, calls the terminal narrative. There's always this terminal narrative. When are the Indians going to die off? When are they going to be gone? So it's still eliminationist. It's in the subconscious of every settler. Why don't they just disappear? You know, it's unresolvable because it's unresolvable until there's some justice done. Thank you.
Yeah. I would like to know, when John Kennedy was in power, or Jimmy Carter.
I'm not hearing you. Can you talk into the microphone? Just put it down there.
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yes? Now?
I think so.
Is it better?
Yeah.
Okay. When John Kennedy was in power, or Jimmy Carter, and now Barack Obama. Has any one of the three have done something to support or to implement legislation to stop or to defend, to support them?
Thank you for that question, because maybe, you know, there's hope here now that, oh, and congratulations for getting rid of Mr. Harper. Because sometimes, you know, there really is bad and worse, and he and George W. Bush, you know, they were quite a pair, along with that British Prime Minister, what was his name? Tony Blair. There's tremendous support that's been sustained, especially for people on the land, Native people on the land, the reservations. I do believe that Barack Obama immediately brought in some of the best, and I think not really just for keeping the enemy close, but really listening to them, like Ramona Bennett, you know, who's long involved in struggles. Her nation, Menominee, was terminated, one of the nations terminated, and she led the struggle to reverse the termination and won. So they are also White House staff. They're not under the Department of the Interior, these advisors. And, of course, the Department of Interior houses the Bureau of Indian Affairs, and he's had very good heads of the Bureau of Indian Affairs. There have never been that many meetings of all kinds of Native people, from movements to tribal officers. The National Congress of American Indians is sort of the organization of all of the Indian reorganization tribes. The Navajo Nation is not a member of it. But they have certainly are having a stronger voice, speaking out more. There's only so much that you can do with when you're federally funded, which they are. Most of our organizations try, not just try, but absolutely refuse any kind of federal money as a compromise. The American Indian Movement was founded on that premise. And some take from municipalities, sometimes even state grants, but, you know, the federal government. So Obama had a tremendous amount of support. He is the first president to ever put put polling booths, you know, for the primary, for the election, after he was nominated, put polling booths in the in reservation lands, because it's very hard to get around, and extended the time of voting. That said, you know, I think it's very limited what an executive can do, because basically Native Americans fall under U.S. law, under the Congress. This is why it's very hard to get cases to the Supreme Court, and that Oneida case, that came out of a long-fought case, because the Supreme Court will say, if it's any sovereignty issue, they will say that is a matter for Congress, because we have this division, delegation of powers in the Constitution. And it's always a good excuse to just pass the buck. So I think Native people are very well aware that they'll get everything they can out of the, and it was pretty sparse under George W. Bush. Clinton was a big disappointment because, well, he's from Arkansas, which is practically the Cherokee Nation. I mean, it was where a lot of Cherokees ended up. And Wilma Mankiller was the president of the Cherokee Nation. She was a militant. She was in the American Indian Movement. She helped occupy Alcatraz. And then she went back home and took her family's allotment and got it put under trust and started an economic development and food program just on her own, you know, and then she got kind of appointed. And then when when Clinton brought in the tribal the president of the Cherokee Nation to be the head of the Bureau of Indian Affairs, Wilma had become his assistant, and she became the first woman head of the Cherokee Nation. Well, it so happened she was very close friends with the Clintons when he was governor of Arkansas, because she went to the University of Arkansas. She completed her PhD commuting. It's not very far, it's just 2 hours, you know, to Little Rock. And so they became very close friends. So when he became president, he asked Wilma, one of the most radical people, and to put together a meeting for him. He was doing this with other groups too, that gay and lesbians, with immigrant rights groups. And this was in his campaign, while he was campaigning. And the thing was, he would say, all of you meet, and then I will come when you say you're ready to meet with you, and you tell me you're unanimous, the one thing that I could do by executive order in the first few months in office that would make you know I'm on your side and I'm going to be there. And amazing to all of us. Now, these are some very conservative. Some of them are, you know, really kind of hardcore Republicans in Oklahoma, some of these tribal chairmen, businessmen, you know, and then the militants, just all kinds of people meeting. And it was amazing. They came up with the one thing was to pardon Leonard Peltier. And he says, of course, I can do that by executive order. They gave him all the materials and everything to look at. And I believe he fully intended to do it. But he started, these things kind of started falling apart, you know, for gays and lesbians. They said, it's not my favorite demand, but that gays in the military, you know, I mean, it is right, but it's kind of disgusting to think of anyone in the U.S. military, but... women now in combat, great rights we've won. But the Army is often the driver of reform, you know, being the main institution in the United States from its birth. So they asked for, they got don't ask, don't tell under Clinton, not gays in the military. He backed off. Well, with Leonard, year after year went by, and he didn't know what he was getting into FBI COINTELPRO stuff. But on his last, when he was going out of office in 1999, he was, you know, that December, well, it was actually 2000, after the election, after the strange appointment of George W. Bush by the Supreme Court, he was no longer beholden to anything, and he gave the signal and to Wilma and to others that he was going to pardon Leonard. It was on his list. And lo and behold, the FBI sent 300 of their special, what do they call it, special agents, that's their title, special agents, with placards, don't free the cop killer, on the White House lawn, demonstrating against the President of the United States. You think that's not a threat? They kill people, you know. So he didn't pardon Leonard. But We keep hoping. The only hope now is, you know, is that is presidential pardon, because everything is so hard to fight. The FBI has the J. Edgar Hoover building of the FBI. He's still their hero, even though he's proven to be insane and corrupt and dangerous. They've only had, besides those two FBI agents killed at Pine Ridge, something like 12 or 13 of their special agents have ever been killed in action. And they're all lined up, their pictures are lined up as you enter the FBI building as martyrs. They have martyrs under them. It's a cult. The FBI is a cult from the very beginning. I mean, it's a very weird thing. And it's, you know, has pretty much no controls over it. So I think that, I really think that Clinton thought he was the boss, but he learned differently, as did many other presidents before him, to keep his mouth shut so about certain things. And you do not, someone has to pay for an FBI agent being killed. And they've got Leonard, and they'll never let him go.
I promised the very last comment to be to Mr. Garin, but possibly you'll be able to speak to the speaker after.
You can come up here if you want. It's shorter. Shorter distance.
It's more of a question than a comment than a question. You talked about the doctrine of discovery in international law. I'm in the midst of reading a book called The Power of Promises. It's a collection of essays that came out of a conference at the University of Washington. A couple of the essays talk about how agreements and treaties and international law and the doctrine of discovery, all of those things are only applicable to the parties to those agreements. And Indigenous people of the Americas were not parties to those agreements, and thus they're not applicable to them. And now, in contemporary time, and this is, of course, in addition to what my brothers over there on the other side of the room talked about earlier, and what's happening contemporarily, most people in BC are aware of the BC treaty process, and one of the primary objectives of the BC treaty process is to get us to sign away our Indigenous title. And I've been advocating for our people to resist that if the provincial and federal crowns will not abandon that objective, then the BC treaty process should be abandoned by our people. The Indigenous title is not ours to sign away. It doesn't belong to us. It belongs to our children and their children and those yet to be born. And that's my comment. And just to close off, I think I'd like to share a bit of humor that comes from, you talked about Vindaloria. In his book, Custer Died for Your Sins, he wrote a series of what he called jokes from Indian country. He says that just before Custer left for the Little Bighorn, he told the people at the Bureau of Indian Affairs, "Don't do anything until I get back," and they're still waiting.
I just had a short announcement. People would have received a leaflet when they came in. It's about a program on November 27th at the Harbor Center on stolen land, First Nations, Palestinians, and the front line of resistance. And it's featuring Dr. Robert Lovelace, who was on the Free Gaza boat twice and has been very active. Also, Glenn Coulthard from UBC. So I hope we'll see a lot of people at that.
Thank you. If everyone could please join me in thanking Dr. Dunbar-Ortiz.